Okay, so in this lecture, I'm just going to a little bit talk about the procedure for testing hypothesis about me. So I have already discussed in my previous lecture that what is hypothesis testing. I have already discussed the criminal trial example, what is type 1 error, what is type 2 error, producer risk, consumer risk. So now I'm just going to practically solve some specific problem in order to further clarify the meaning of hypothesis testing. So as you people know that always the alternative hypothesis contains some inequality sign, because when the null hypothesis show the equal sign, then alternative hypothesis will show unequal sign. When it is an unequal sign, it's mean that the tail is two tail test. Because if, for example, if I want to ask you that in my pocket there are 100 rupees, you will say no, this is not exactly 100 rupees. So now you are not clear that it is more than 100 rupees or it is less than 100 rupees. So when we are not clear, it will be not equal to, in that case, it will be a two tail test. Okay. If I say that in my pocket there are 10 rupees or less than 10 rupees, so the alternative will be no, in your pocket there are more than 10 rupees. So that will be the right tail test. So mean this sign will showing the right tail test. And when it is showing less than, because alternative hypothesis will always contain the sign of inequality, so mean in this case it will be left tail test. So now I am just going to show you a very simple example in which we will also construct these tail tests, and I will show you. But before going to that, you need to understand some specific postulate, procedure for testing hypothesis about me, case 1. So why we call it case 1? Because in this case, population standard deviation is known. So I mean, in such like question, in such like experiment, they will give you standard deviation. Okay. And the null hypothesis, maybe it will depend on the tail of test. If it is equal to, let's suppose mean is equal to 10, population mean is equal to 10. So the alternative for this will be not equal to 10. So that is why it will be two tail test. If it show, if they ask you that the mean is less than or equal to 10, let's suppose, so the opposite of this one will be greater than. Okay, so this is right tail test. When it is greater than, so it will be lying in the right hand side. If we say that the mean of a specific population is greater than or equal to, so the alternative will be H1, the alternative hypothesis will be mu is less than equal to, let's suppose, 10. So it will basically showing you a left tail test. The second step in the hypothesis testing is the level of significance. We basically choose alpha. What is our threshold? What is the risk involved in a specific production? Let's suppose normally in normal situation, in most of the experiment, the researcher, the analyst, they use level of significance as 5%. So in those questions where they not mention the value of alpha, we will just choose alpha is equal to 0.05. So basically we have already studied, this is called the producer risk. That means if a producer produce 100 units, so there will be a chance, there will be a risk of 5%. The third step, so it basically depends on your intuition, it depends on your experience, but normally if you not know what to specifically keep the alpha value, so just put it 0.05. The third step in the hypothesis testing is the test statistic. So basically we are now conducting hypothesis testing about mean, so that is why we will using the Z standard standard normal distribution. So Z is equal to X bar, which is the sample mean minus the population mean divided by this is standard deviation divided by square root of the sample size. So I mean, if you want to conduct hypothesis tests for the population, so this formula will be specifically for the population. In the most of the books, the formula is changed for the proportion. Okay, sorry, for a hypothesis about proportion, hypothesis about variances, so we will use another formula. So for this purpose, for the hypothesis testing about mean, we will use this formula, because we only want to analyze one mean. If we have two mean, then we will conduct hypothesis testing about two mean. Okay, then in third, in the fourth step, we will basically calculate this Z value. So what is the Z value? So mean, if they give you some specific value for population mean, then you will collect a sample, you will calculate this. And as I already mentioned, in the case 1, the population standard deviation will be known. So maybe they will give you some variance. So when you take the square root of that variance, you will get the standard deviation. And you already know that how many sample unit, how many units you take as a sample. So you will put this value. Calculation, we will calculate the value of Z. Then in the next step, when we calculate the value of Z, then we will then further construct. If it is a two-tailed test, as I already mentioned, that if it is a two-tailed test, you will construct a hypothesis testing for two-tailed test. If it is a right-tailed test, if it is a left-tailed test. So now in this example, in this screen, you can see that the critical region, the fifth step will be the critical region. Is our alternative hypothesis showing two-tailed test, left-tailed test? So this is now right-tailed test, this is left-tailed test. So these both are called one-tailed test. And this one is called two-tailed test. Two-tailed test is being, as I already mentioned, that for example, if I say that there are 10 rupees in my pocket, you say no, there are more than 10 rupees. So if it is more than, then it will be the right test. If you say that if it is, there are less than 10 rupees, so it will be in this region. But you say no, there are not 10 rupees. So now you are not sure that there are not 10 rupees mean there are more than 10 rupees, there are less than 10 rupees. So that is why we will split that region into portions. One portion will be in the upper side and one portion will be the downside. As you people know that standard deviation mean is equal to 0. 50% lie, area lying at this side and 50% lying at this side. Okay. And this middle region is the acceptance region, which is also calculated as 1 minus alpha. 1 minus alpha mean the in your production, let's suppose 95% will be the effective. The 5% will be the defective. But we not know that the defective, how much portion will be in this and how much. So that is why we divide alpha into tail test by 2. And we split this rejected area into portion. And we know that 50% over there and 50% over there, because this is a standard normal distribution and it is a symmetric distribution. So we will split this alpha by 2. If it is a right tail test, then we will use Z alpha. We will not divide with 2, because as I already mentioned that there are more than 10 rupees in your pocket. So mean you say that there are 10 rupees, let's suppose, or there are less than or equal to 10 rupees, they will say that there are more than 10 rupees. So definitely this is the rejection region. You will check your null hypothesis. If the values lie in this region, you will accept your null hypothesis. If the value lie in this region, you will definitely reject the null hypothesis. Similarly, for the left tail test, the alternative hypothesis will claim that there are less than 10 rupees in your pocket. So it will be this area. Okay, you will say that there are more than or equal to 10 rupees. So this will be your acceptance region, this will be your rejection region. So mean in two tail tests, that is why we divide with 2, because we are not sure that there are more than 10 rupees or there are less than 10 rupees. So that is why we will split that into portion. The sixth step is the conclusion. Conclusion mean we will show, we will check when that where our Z value. So where our Z calculated value lies. Is it lie in the accepted region or is it lie in the rejected region? So we will also calculate if you want to check the P value. So as I already mentioned in my previous slides that how you will interpret, how you will calculate the p-value. So when you calculate the p-value, if p-value is less than level of significance, you will definitely reject H0. If p-value is greater than level of significance, definitely we will accept H0. And from the table, you can also calculate these values. I will show you in a simple example that how we will calculate these values and how we will check that the Z calculated value lie in the accepted region or it lie in the rejected region. So on the basis of that, we will accept or we will reject the null hypothesis. So, as I already mentioned that how you will use the Z table. So, now I am just going to show you once again the Z table. So, you can see that if the alpha value is 10%, let's suppose the level of significance is 10%. If it is a two-tailed test. So, in two-tailed test, what we will do? Because we not know that where is it? Is it right side or is it on the left side? So, what we will do? We will divide this region. Okay. And we will divide this is because this is 0. So, Z alpha by 2. Alpha by 2 and minus Z alpha by 2. So when you divide this alpha by 2, let's suppose it will be 0.05. So the acceptance region will be, this region will be 1 minus 0.05. So 1 minus 0.05 will be equal to 0.95. Now in the table, we want to find this 0.95. So how you will have a look at the table? So now I'm just going to show you that how you will calculate Z value for this area 0.95%, because this is the accepted region, this is my accepted region and these are the rejected region. So 10% area lie in the rejected region, but we will consider this whole area because it starts from minus infinity to infinity. So we basically divide this 0.05, 1 minus alpha, so 1 minus alpha means 0.95. Now we will find the value of Z, that what this value will be when you divide 0.10 by 2, so it will be 0.05. Okay, N1 minus alpha 0.05 will be 0.95. So, you can have a look that. So, you can see that in the table, where is the 95% area lies. This is my exact table, you can see this. So, 0.95 is this one, you can see this one, because this one is above 0.95%. So, this area in the Z, because this first column showing Z value, so this is 1.6 and this is 42 decimal place. So, that is why we will write 1.64. So, you can see this is 1.64. So, this is 1.64, this will be equal to 1.64 and this will be equal to minus 1.64. Because as I already mentioned, this is symmetric distribution, 50% area lie on this side. So, the value on this side will be equal to the other side, only the sign will be changed. So, that is why it will be minus 1.64 and plus 1.64, because this is a two-tailed test. If it is one-sided test, okay, one-sided mean if it is the right side. So, this will be, how you will interpret this? It will be a one-sided test. So, it will be this one, 1 minus alpha, Z alpha. This is our accepted region and this is my rejected region. So, 1 minus 0.10, it will be 0.90. Now, we want what will be the Z value for this 0.90. What area value, the measure of 0.90 will be equal to Z, which value the Z will be. So, you can find this from the table. So, this is our Z table. Now, 0.90, 90% area. So, 90% area is which one? Okay, 1.28, because this 90 is above than 90. So, this one is approaching to 90, because automatically this one is 9. So, automatically this is also 9. So, this will be 9 and this will be 0. So, this is 90. And what is the value of Z for this one? It is 1.28. So, that is why we just write 1.28. So, 1.28. Okay. Now, one side it to the left. So, how you will sketch this? You will sketch it at this way. Okay. Let's suppose this is our normal curve. So, this is our minus Z alpha. This is 1 minus alpha. This is our accepted region. And this is my rejected region. Now, how we will calculate 1 minus, because alpha value is 10%. So, this is 10%, which will be equal to 0.90. So, once again, because from this side, because this is Z is equal to 0 on this side, so you have already calculated this 1.28. On this side, it will be equal to, because this is symmetric. But on this side, the Z value is positive and on this side, the Z value is negative. So, this will be 1 minus 0.28. So, at this way you will interpret, you will calculate the values. For example, now this is 0.05. So, for 0.05, if it is a two-tailed test, so 0.05 will be divided with 2. So, when you divide it with 2, it will be 0.025. Okay, for two-tailed test, it will be, for two-tailed test, you will divide this, it will be plus Z alpha by 2 and minus Z alpha by 2. 1 minus 0.025. So, 1 minus 0.025 is equal to 0.975. 0.975. Now, in the table, you need to find out 0.975. So, where is 0.975? 0.975 will be 1.96. You can see this one, this value, 0.9. So, 1.9 and this is the 2 decimal place value, 1.96. So, this is 1.96 will be on this value, on this side it will be minus 1.96. Similarly, for the right tail test, you will also calculate this, you will not divide it, so you will calculate 1 minus 0.05, so you will be find out 0.64 and I already calculate 1.64 for 95% area. Similarly, for the left tail test, you will also calculate. If it is 2, so at this way, you will calculate the Z values from the table. Okay. Now, I am just going to discuss a very simple example. So, now this is just a basic example, how you will extract the data from this and how you will know that where to use hypothesis testing. Suppose that a construction firm has just purchased a large supply of cable. They have been guaranteed to have an average breaking strength of at least 7000 psi. So, now this is basically the mean. This is mean. Average is what? Mean of population. Mean of the whole cable. Now, they are claiming this, that this is the average PCI of our cable. Let's suppose Pakistan cable. To verify this claim, The firm has decided to take an A&M sample. For example, in order to verify their claim, an inspector visited to that area and they take a sample of 10 from those cables. So N is equal to 10. To determine their breaking strength, they will then use the result of this experiment to ascertain whether or not they accept the cable manufacturer hypothesis that the population weighs at least 7,000 pounds per square inch. So now, because this is our mean, which is 7,000, they claim for this, we took a sample of 10. So let's suppose this is our sample basically. So first sample, the first one, okay, let's suppose the PSI is, let's suppose 6,500, the other one is 6,700, the third one is 7,000, okay. So at this one, 1, 2, 3, you will take up to 10. So now you need to calculate standard deviation. So how you will calculate standard deviation? Okay, standard deviation, you know the formula of standard deviation, because the variance formula is x minus x bar whole square, okay, divided by n minus 1. So this will be the standard deviation basically. When you calculate this, you will use this test x bar minus mu, because from this you will also calculate x bar, summation x by n, x bar minus mu, and the standard deviation. So the sample standard deviation formula you will be used, because the population standard deviation is not known. So when you calculate this, then you will check, let's suppose you want to keep this level 0.05, then you will check that the claim of this organization is true. Is it acceptable or is it not acceptable? So in order to further clarify, I'm just going to discuss a very simple example. For example, past experience has shown that the score of student who take a certain mathematics test are normally distributed with mean 75. So they are talking about the students. We not know how many students, because this represents the population. So mean will be 75, and variance, so this is variance, sigma square. Normally when we take the square root, we will get the standard deviation. The mathematics department would like to know whether this year group of 16 are typical. So now they take a 16 student sample, okay, from the mathematics department. So n is equal to 16. They decide to test the hypothesis that this year students are typical against alternative, that they are not typical. So these are two different categories, that they are typical or not typical. So the null hypothesis will be that they are typical. They are equal to, because they already mentioned, their mathematics tests are not distributed with mean 75. Okay. So we will consider, we will construct null hypothesis, which is mu is equal to 75. So they decide to test the hypothesis that this year students are typical against the alternative. Now they are talking about alternative, that they are not typical. So they are typical 75, they are not typical. So from this alternative, as I already mentioned, we will know that what kind of test is it. If it is not equal to its mean, we not know that it will be more than 75 or it will be less than 75. When you not know, so you will construct two rejected regions. That is why it is called two-tailed test. This will be rejected region, this will be rejected region. So if you choose level of significance 0.05%, so you will divide this with 2. So 0.025 will be on the upper edge and 0.025 will be on the lower edge. Now they already mentioned some more information when the student take the test, the average score. So now they are talking about those 16 students which they took as a sample. So when the student take the test, the average score is 82. So average score of what? This is sample. So x bar will be 82. What conclusion should be drawn? So as I already mentioned, in the case 1, is it a case 1? Yes, this is a case 1, because as I already mentioned, in the case 1, what they will do? Population standard deviation is known. So yes, population standard deviation is known. They give us the variance of population. So when you take the square root of population, you will get standard deviation. So in our question, the variance is 36. So when you take the square root, you will get 6. And basically we use this one. Mu is equal to 75 and mu is not equal to 75. Second step will be level of significance. So my level of significance is, this is the second step, level of significance. We want to check on 0.05%. The third step is test statistic. So as I already mentioned, that test statistic will be x bar minus mu divided by standard deviation by square root of sample size n. Now the fourth step will be calculation. Now you need to put the values in this statistic test. 82 as you see that 82 is mentioned in the information, minus mu is 75 divided by standard deviation. So standard deviation will be what? If you take the square root of this, it will be, so when you take the square root of, because this is now s square, so let me take the square root of this, okay, it will be cancelled, and similarly it will be 6. So standard deviation is 6. So we just put this 6 value divided by n is 16. So we just put, when we simplify it, we will get 4.67. Now this is called calculated value of z. Now we need to construct a critical region to find the p value. This is very, very important. You need to understand how you will calculate the p value and how you will interpret your results. So, because we want to construct, this is a two-tailed test, on the basis of this we decide that is a two-tailed test, that this year students are typical against the term, they are not typical. If they are not typical, then what? They are more than typical or they are less than typical. So, we want to calculate this. So, what we will do? We will divide this in z alpha by 2, and this will be minus z alpha by 2. So, this is our accepted region and these two are our rejected region. So, this is our critical region. So, 0 alpha by 2, when you divide it, 0.05. So, 0.05 divided by 2. So, it will be 0.025. So, 1 minus alpha by 2, because this is 1 minus alpha by 2. So, it will be 0.975. Now, we want to have a look for the value of 0.975. So, we will go to the table, that what is the value for 0.975. So, on this side 0.975 and on this side 0.975. So, for 0.975, you can see this is 0.975 and against this the value of z is 1.9 and this is 6. So, z value will be 1.9 and 2 decimal place is 6. So, that is why we just write plus 1.96, and this is a symmetrical distribution, 50% on this side and 50% on this side, this will be automatically minus 1.96. So, we already calculated the range. Now, you need to find out where your z calculated value lies, which is 4.67. So, starting from 0, let's suppose this is 1, this is 1.96, so where it will be lying? 4.67, it will be 4.67. You see 4.67 at this, and this is the rejected region. So, what we will do? We will reject our null hypothesis. Why we will reject? Because our null hypothesis is lying in the rejected region. If it is lying in the accepted region, then we will accept H0. But actually, the H0 value, the calculated value, which we have calculated, lying in the rejected region. So, in this case, we will accept alternative hypothesis. That this is not equal to, that sorry, this is mean is not equal to 75. Okay, so at this way you will calculate. You can also calculate p value. So, what will be the p value? So, you people know, in order to calculate p value, I am just writing at this place, p z is greater than 1.96, which is equal to probability of z is less than minus 1.96. Yes, you know, we change the sign, so this is minus 1.96. So, what is the value of minus 1.96 in the table? Minus 1.96. So, this is our table. What is the value for minus 1.96? Minus 1.96, you can see, this is also the z table, but these are the negative value, minus 1.96. So, come at this place, minus 1.96. So, this is minus 1.9 and this is 6 columns, 2 decimal places. So, 0.0250. This is our p value, 0.025. So, the p value from the table is 0.025. So, actually, the p value is, which is 0.025, which is less than level of significance. 0.025 is less than 0.05. So, when the p value is less than this, this will be, H0 will be rejected. If p value is greater than level of significance, then we will accept H0. So, at both way. So, if you are using specific software will show you this p value. But you can also using the z table, just like as I already mentioned. So, you can calculate accepted region bounds and rejected region bounds. So, when you calculate, you check this value, that it is lying in the rejected region or it is lying in accepted region. Then on the basis of this, you will decide. So, when you solve, I hope that you understand these things. Now you need to solve this question. This is an assignment. When you go to these questions, you will further understand that how you will calculate the Z value, how you will understand the level of significance, how you will calculate the accepted region and rejected region. So you need to try these questions. Soon we will discuss these questions in the interactive session. Thank you.